Okay, for today's lecture, I'm going to touch on how to value a private health companies. Yeah. Okay. It's also called private limited companies. As you know, there are two types of companies. There is private limited companies and public listed company. Yeah. So for today, we are going to touch on the private limited company. Yeah. Okay, what is private limited company? Kalau you tak belajar, you dah tahu ke tak?
Syarikat persendirian. Syarikat sendirian berhad.
Syarikat sendirian berhad. Okay, kita tahu ya sebenarnya ada beberapa jenis syarikat dekat Malaysia ni. Kita ada sole proprietorship ataupun syarikat pemilikan tunggal. Yeah. We have partnership ataupun syarikat perkongsian. And then we have syarikat sendirian berhad. Yeah. So all these three fall under private limited company. Yeah. And the other one is public listed company. Yeah. That one is public company. Okay. So basically, a private company is company that not listed on any stock exchange. Yeah. Dia tidak disenaraikan di bursa saham. Yeah. Okay. So it's rather owned by few high net worth individual. Yeah. Like if pemilikan tunggal. Yeah. Or in English is called sole proprietorship. Is only owned by one person. Yeah. Okay. Is perkongsian or partnership. Yeah. Is owned by a few owners. Yeah. A few shareholders. And number three, the syarikat sendirian berhad or private limited company owned by few and not as many as public listed company. Because why? Their stock ataupun saham ya tidak dilisted di public listed company ya, dia privately owned ya. Okay. Okay, so what is good for being a private company? Because it does give its owner a lot of autonomy and freedom. You as owner, kalau you let's say a sole proprietorship ya, you are the kuasa ya. You own the company. Suka hati you lah nak buat macam mana. Yeah. Okay. So you can make fast decision. Yeah. Kalau you nak employ orang pun, you nak employ semua saudara mara you kat dalam company, you pun boleh. Yeah. Because you have power in hiring processes. Yeah. In term of capital also, yeah, you nak letak capital dia berapa. It's up to you. Okay, let me show lah besar sikit kan. Okay. So let's see what is an advantage being a private company. Okay. First, it doesn't need to adhere to any KLSE and SC regulation. Ya, dia tak payah penuhi ya syarat-syarat bursa saham ataupun Kuala Lumpur Stock Exchange dan juga Securities Commission. For a public listed company, ya, preparing document for KLSE and SC is quite expensive. Ya, involve a lot of money. So being a private company can save a lot of money. That is one advantage. So how about the disadvantage? Okay, being a private company, selling shares in the private market is pretty difficult. Let's say you own a valuation firm. Yeah? There are, let's say, four shareholders. You own 25%. Yeah? you want to, let's say you no longer interested to be the shareholders, yeah, or in that company, you want to share your 25% shares, yeah. It's not easy. Yeah? It's not like the in for public listed company, you can always sell it at the KLSE, yeah, at the stock exchange. But for private company, you have to search for private individual who is willing to buy over your shares. So we can say that private shares are illiquid, yeah, tidak cair, yeah. Tidak cair maknanya susah untuk kita tukar kepada bentuk keuangan, bentuk duit lah, ya. Yeah. Okay. Okay, so we have a look at type of privately held company. First, like I said just now, sole proprietorship, or in Bahasa Malaysia, pemilikan tunggal. Yeah. Bila kita sebut sole, that means only one, yeah, only one owner, yeah. Okay, a sole proprietorship company doesn't have a separate entity. It's same as the entity of the person. Yeah. Let's say I open a valuation firm owned by myself. Yeah, let's say I name the company as Zai & Co. Yeah, Zai & Co. But I am the only sole owner, yeah, sole proprietor. Actually, the company Zai & Co does not have separate entity with me myself, with Zahiria. Yeah. So let's say for income tax also, yeah, we have to merge it, yeah, together. Yeah. Kalau this company, the Zai & Co, goes bankrupt, yeah, that means Zahiria also goes bankrupt, yeah. Same with hutang, yeah. Kalau yang berhutang is the company Zai & Co, bermakna if Zai & Co cannot pay the loan, Zahiria has to pay the loan, yeah. It's the same entity. The best thing is the owner of company gets the unlimited freedom, yeah, to make her or his own decision, yeah. Like me, I say I own the Zai & Co as sole proprietor, suka hati I lah, yeah. I nak ambil duit tu, yeah, nak ambil duit daripada Zai & Co, I nak beli apa-apa guna duit company, boleh, yeah. I don't have limit, yeah, because it's actually one entity with myself, yeah. But at the same time, the risk is huge and raising money become way too difficult, yeah. Okay, and the company will cease operation when the owner die, yeah. So when the owner die, company tu matilah sama because it's one entity with the owner, yeah. Okay, untuk contoh, I dah bagi contoh tadi, yeah. Okay. So the second type of privately held company is partnership, yeah, or in Bahasa Malaysia, syarikat perkongsian, yeah. Partnership is actually an extension of a sole proprietor, yeah. But the difference is sole proprietorship only one owner, but for partnership company it has 2 to 20 partners, yeah. So lebih daripada seorang partner, yeah. Bila lebih dari seorang partner, you have to register your company as partnership. I nak tanya you, kalau dekat Malaysia, you nak register dekat mana? Kalau you buka sole proprietor or partnership, tahu tak?
SSM.
SSM.
SSM, ya, yeah, betul. SSM nanti dia akan keluarkan satu sijil, ya, yeah, sijil. So dengan sijil tu you boleh buat bisnes lah. Let's say you nak buka bisnes, nak jual air batu ke apa ke, Air batu, ais, air batu, ais. Okay. So in term of liability, yeah, the owners have the same unlimited liability and at the same unlimited autonomy to make decision. So let's say kalau ada two partners, yeah, dua-dua, yeah, dua-dua ni dia mempunyai dua-dua ataupun kalau dia ada 20 partners pun, all of them have the same unlimited liability, yeah, dan juga unlimited autonomy, yeah, sama-sama aja kuasa. Okay, each partnership are driven by partnership agreement, ya, selalunya kalau you open a partnership company, you kena ada, ya, perjanjian perkongsian, ya, perjanjian perkongsian tu macam-macam lah dalam tu, you boleh include in term of management, in term of managing the account and etc. At large, for consultancy business, yeah, like legal firm, valuation firm, M&E consultant, huh, the company will cease operation once the owners die. Yeah, kalau semuanya meninggal, yeah, let's say kalau ada dua orang, yeah, kalau ada dua orang, A and B, B meninggal, tinggal A, dia terpaksa cease operation. Yeah. Ataupun dibuat macam mana, tukarkan jadi sole proprietor, yeah. So the partnership tu memang kena berhentikan, yeah. Tapi let's say kalau dia ada lima partners, seorang je meninggal, dia masih boleh beroperasi, yeah, dengan empat partners yang tinggal. Dan ini pun based pada the partnership agreement, ya. Partnership agreement tu ada tulis apa, ya. Let's say kalau the partnership agreement kata kalau salah seorang meninggal, the company must cease operation, memang cease operation, ya. Yang empat ni dia terpaksa buka new partnership. Okay, ni syarikat, dan nombor tiga ni limited liabilities company, ya, atau yang inilah yang kita panggil sebagai syarikat sendirian berhad, ya. Okay, syarikat sendirian berhad, ya, have more than multiple owners and share the responsibility, ya. So kalau the partnership just now is between 2 to 20 persons, ya, 2 to 20 partners, for syarikat sendirian berhad it can goes up to 50, ya, 50 shareholders, ya. Okay, so it's limited liability and it is a separate entity in nature. Yeah, separate between the shareholders and the company. Let's say the company goes bankrupt, the shareholder won't go bankrupt. Yeah, kalau company itu berhutang, yeah, hutang itu perlu dibayar oleh syarikat. Yeah, the shareholder tak ada kena mengena. Yeah, so that's why orang buka syarikat sendirian berhad. Yeah. Kalau for the sole proprietor and partnership tadi, kalau the company berhutang, company tak boleh bayar hutang, the partners or the sole proprietor kena bayarkan hutang tersebut. Yeah, tapi kalau syarikat sendirian berhad, dia hanya limited to the syarikat. Yeah, dia tidak akan kacau shareholders lah. So that's why it's good to register your company as a private limited company, syarikat sendirian berhad, ya, yeah. Okay, so then the company will continue despite the shareholder dies, ya, yeah. Kalau shareholder meninggal ke, shareholder apa ke, syarikat tu tetap akan berjalan, ya, yeah. Kebanyakan company, ya, yeah, dia akan cuba tubuhkan syarikat sendirian berhad, ya, untuk menyelamatkan shareholders. Okay, this is a summary of privately held companies, ya. Yeah. Kita tengok dari in term of registration, ya. The registration is under Registration of Business Act 1956. If a partnership is under Partnership Act 1961, ya. And private limited under Company Act 1965, ya. Akta Syarikat, ya, 1965. Ya. Okay, so kalau you nak buka whichever business, ya, sama ada sole proprietor, partnership atau private limited company at the Suruhanjaya Syarikat Malaysia, this is what this is the act that related to your company. Okay. So capital, your modal, untuk syarikat sole proprietor, the modal is from whom? Is from the owner or the proprietor, ya. Macam kalau saya tadi, Zai & Co, ya, buka company, modal dia dari mana? Daripada poket saya. Okay. Kalau partnership, modalnya daripada all the partners, ya. Kalau ada dua partner, daripada dua partners tersebutlah. Kalau ada 20 partners, daripada 20 partners, ya. Okay. Untuk private limited company, ya, modal dia daripada pemegang saham or shareholders. Yes, shareholders. So remember, ownership, ya, in term of ownership, for sole proprietor is only 1%, ya. For partnership is between 2 to 20 partners, ya. And for private limited company is between 2 to 50 shareholders. Management, ya. Who manage the company? So sole proprietor is very clear, ya, the owner, the proprietor yang satu je. Okay. For partnership by few partners, let's say this partnership have 20 shareholders. Boleh tak company kalau 20 orang manage? Pening kan, too many. So they normally select a few partners, ya, to take care of the management of the companies. Okay. How about private limited companies? Now, let's say the company have 30 shareholders. Not all will manage the company. They will appoint board of directors. Pernah dengar tak board of directors? Lembaga pengarah. Ya, lembaga pengarah ni diputuskan oleh shareholders lah. Ya, siapa yang mereka nak lantik sebagai ahli lembaga pengarah, ya. It can be the shareholders, and lembaga pengarah juga boleh, ya, daripada dipilih daripada bukan shareholders, ya. Okay. Liability, ya, in term of liability, I told you just now, so proprietor is unlimited, ya. Kalau company tak bayar hutang, boleh saman owner, ya, tak payah saman company, saman owner, ya. Begitu juga partnership, ya. Partnership, the liability also unlimited, you can sue the partners, ya. Okay, so private limited company, ya, the liability is limited. You cannot sue shareholder, tapi kalau you nak sue, you sue the company, ya. Okay. Profit and loss, kalau ada untung, ada rugi, apa jadi? Kalau anda sole proprietor, untung rugi semua pergi pada owner, ya. Yeah? Okey. Kalau partnership, untung rugi semua share, dikongsi, ya, yeah? Share between partners, ya. Yeah? Tapi kalau private limited company, kalau ada untung rugi, dia akan bayar kepada shareholders. Tak dibayar, bayar tak semua, ya. Dia akan dibayar dalam bentuk dividen, ya. Macam kalau you invest lah, kalau you melabur dalam mana-mana syarikat, ya. Jadi at the end, ya, ujung tahun ke, it depends on the financial year, close bila, dia akan declare dividends, ya. Keuntungan daripada saham. Okay. So financial statement, untuk syarikat sole proprietor, you tak payah buat financial statement, ya, untuk diserahkan kepada SSM, ya, tak perlu. Partnership juga tidak perlu. Tapi for private limited company, you have to have proper record of the financial statement. Then the financial statement should be audited. Yeah, and report to the CCM. CCM stands for what? Kalau bahasa Melayu tadi, you dah sebutlah SSM ya. Suruhanjaya Syarikat Malaysia. In English dia?
Company Commission Malaysia.
Okay. Okay, so we goes again to the advantage of privately held company. Ya. Bila you dah faham, there are three types of privately held company tau. So you, saya rasa kat sini you senang lah nak faham ya. Control in term of control and autonomy ya, complete autonomy over operational decision ya. So kalau you owner, you ada as a sole proprietor, you have 100% autonomy. Yeah, you can decide whatever you want to decide. Yeah? And then you have to, you don't have to worry about regulation. Kenapa? Tak payah. Sebab you tak payah hantar apa-apa penyata kepada the CCM ataupun SSM tadi. Yeah? And then the second one is non-disclosure right. Yeah, you tak payah disclose. Yeah? Doesn't need to incur a huge cost of preparing the document for KLSC or SC requirements. You can remain privileged and privacy in respect of internal trade strategies and final statement. Since you don't have to submit anything to the SSM, to KLSC or whoever, so you can remain private. Your privacy. Nobody knows your company tu untung ke, your company tu rugi ke, yeah? Nobody knows. Only you knows. Okay. Number three, the structure of taxation. Kan? Ramai orang cuba lari daripada bayar cukai kan? Betul tak? So, for privately held company, the owner can decide how they would structure the company. Able to manipulate the financial statement. Yeah. Syarikat Sdn Bhd pun. Yeah, sebab tu they employ good accountants. Yeah, because they want to manipulate the financial statement. Supaya nampak untung tak banyak, nak kurangkan bayar cukai. Atau sometimes dia saja je nak nampakkan untung banyak walaupun rugi. Mengapa? Mungkin sebab dia nak tarik pemegang saham tertentu ya, untuk beli saham syarikat tersebut. Yeah. So inilah bagusnya ya, privately held company. And then confidentiality can be maintained. Ya. So the public companies, the complete companies cannot keep the secret. Ya. Kalau public companies, everything they have to declare. Ya. They have to, if let's say they want to buy property, they have to inform the Securities Commission. They have to inform the KLSC. They have to announce in the newspapers, ya. Yeah? Sebab tu you selalu nampak announcement, ya. Yeah? Let's say Sunway, ya. Yeah? Sunway Groups acquiring properties in where, ya. Yeah? Dan di situ dia kena declare berapa ada harga dia. Ya, selalu akan ada information ya, berapa luas. That's why ya, sometimes as a valuer kita kadang-kadang boleh gunakan ya, announcement of the public listed company as sale evidence ya. Because the information is there ya, kita boleh analyze. Okay, privately held company can keep their confidentiality and don't need to disclose legal statement. Yeah, okay. Employees compensation and other confidential information. Yeah, so kita kalau private held company kita tak payah tahu. Director kita bayar 2 juta setahun pun kita tak perlu declare. Yeah, kalau public listed company, you can check. Ya, kalau CEO dia gaji berapa, you buka je dia punya annual report, you boleh cari ya, kat mana. Ya, gaji everything ya, must be declare. Ya, sebab tu mengapa orang pertikai? Oh, they say Malaysia Airlines bayar gaji CEO dia terlalu tinggi. Macam mana orang tahu gaji dia terlalu tinggi? Because they have to declare. Yeah, you can find ways to find the information. Tapi kalau private lihat company, tak payah. Yeah, tak ada. Siapa tahu? Okay. Okay, almost no issues regarding litigation. Yeah, tak ada orang nak saman. Yeah, sebab public companies disclose all. Public company, everything you have to disclose. Yeah, as a result, they are more vulnerable to lawsuits. Yeah, orang nampak. Okay, the shareholder nampak. Eh, ini ada berlaku salah laku. Yeah, so they can sue. Yeah, but then but private limited company sebab dia tak disclose. Yeah, kalau ada salah laku ke apa ke orang tak tahu, so tak ada issues lah regarding litigation. On the other hand, privately held company don't need to disclose their legal matters or any sensitive information. Yeah, as a result, they can skip the issues regarding litigation by all means. Yeah, like katalah dia disaman, the company disaman sebab tak bayar hutang. Yeah, tapi dia boleh senyap-senyap lah. Yeah, pergi court apa. Yeah, so dia tak payah disclose. Yeah, sama ada the final judgement tu dia kena bayar hutang ke atau dia tak perlu bayar hutang ke apa ke, nobody knows. Yeah, tapi if a public listed company, semua tu kena disclose. Okay, tadi kita pergi dah kepada advantages dia. Kalau that advantages is too good, why people still want to go for public listed company? Mengapa nak jadikan company tu private listed company? Sebab dia ada juga disadvantages. Yeah, pertama, limited capital. Ya, yeah, modal. Yeah, limited in sourcing share capital. Yeah, or equity. Yeah, kalau let's say syarikat Sdn Bhd just now, ya, yeah, dia boleh ada pemegang saham berapa orang maksima? Semua tidur ke ni? Hello?
Ada.
So kalau syarikat Sdn Bhd tadi ada berapa orang maksima boleh ada shareholders?
Sdn Bhd sampai 50.
Ha, 50 orang sahaja kan? Ha, so dia boleh dapatkan capital daripada 50 orang tersebut saja. So it's limited, ya. Yeah? Kalau public listed companies, ya, yeah, you boleh perdagangkan your shares in BSKL, ya. Yeah? Anybody can buy your shares, ya. Yeah? Bila orang beli saham, maknanya orang akan bagi duit, ya. Yeah? Duit tu akan dijadikan sebagai capital, ya, yeah? Modal kepada syarikat. So this is the one advantage of a privately held company, yeah, limited in sourcing share capital. Okay. Secondly, unlimited responsibility or liability. As there are no separate entity for sole proprietorship business and sole proprietor, yeah. Kalau yang saya sebut tadilah, ya, yeah, untuk sole proprietorship and partnership, ya. Yeah, there are no separate entities with the person, yeah, the owner. So it's unlimited responsibility to the owner, yeah. Okay. Okay, if there are any lawsuit and the court verdict is against them, the court may take your personal asset beyond the asset of your business, yeah. Kalaulah saya, macam saya sebut tadi, kalau katalah company itu berhutang, ya, company tak bayar hutang dan disaman, dan bila disaman dia tengok aset company tak cukup pun untuk bayar hutang tu, so dia boleh ambil, ya, aset daripada personal, ya, daripada owner tu, ya, personally. So kita tengok walaupun ada disadvantage, why private companies remain private? Mengapa dia tak pergi public listed kalau dia tak boleh dapatkan wang yang banyak untuk modal, ya? Macam saya sebut tadi. So there are two example of a big company, a giant company that remain as private limited company. That is Jekyll, ya. Jekyll besar kan? Dia tahu tak Jekyll ni company apa?
Pakaian.
Textile.
Ha, textile. Dia besar tau. Boleh katakan semua bandar kat bandar-bandar besar dekat Malaysia dia ada tau. Ha. Ni Dell ya, komputer. Yang komputer Dell tu dia pun remain private. Mengapa dia tak pergi public listed? Ya, macam company-company lain. So sebab mengapa? Kalau dia pergi public, ya, dia boleh raise money, ya, easier compared to remain private. One of the because to conduct an IPO, ya, bila nak bila nak public listedkan company tu, dia kena conduct an IPO. A corporation, yeah, needs to invest you money which a privately held company may not want to invest, yeah. So kadang-kadang dia kata alah membazir duit je, yeah, bila nak issue IPO ni, bila nak conduct IPO ni, yeah. So memakan duit yang belanja yang banyak, yeah, pada permulaan. At the same time, yeah, privately held company can align its business objective around it missions. Yang ni kita tahulah sebab private company is very small. Dia punya apa ni, decision maker pun kurang. So dia senang nak align the business. Yeah. Okay. So kadang-kadang ya, company ni dia dah ada dia punya clients. Ya, yeah, clients yang bagus. Ya, yeah, senarai klien yang bagus. Jadi dia kata buat apa dia susah-susah nak pergi public, ya, yeah? Baik dia maintain as private company saja, ya, yeah? And then lepas tu apa ni, keuntungan semua boleh diperolehi sendiri, ya, yeah? Among dia punya the small numbers of shareholders compared to dia kalau company tu dijadikan public listed company, dia kena share all the profits with Lasha, with all the shareholders. Okay. In term of valuation, how to determine the market value of company? Yeah, that publicly trades on a stock exchange. Senang saja. Ya, kalau company nak tentukan value company yang di apa ni, di trade, yang di urus niaga, ya, di bursa saham, kita senang je, ya, tengok ada berapa jumlah saham, just time the harga saham, ya, the stock price, ya, you just time apa, NOSO times price of the stock, so you get the total value, kan. However, yeah, for private companies, the process is not as straightforward or transparent. Yeah. Sebab kalau private company, saham dia tu, nilai saham dia tu, satu saham tu nilai dia berapa? You tak boleh, susah nak tahu, kan? So the process is susah sikit lah, yeah, compared to the public company. Susah-susah pun senang. Nanti saya tunjuk contoh at the end of this lecture. Okay, private company do not report their financial publicly and since there no stock listed on an exchange, it's often difficult to determine a value of the company. Okay. Actually, yeah, the process of valuing private company is no different from the process of value public companies. Yeah. Macam yang kita dah belajar, there are three approaches. Income approach, you can use income approach. Secondly, market approach, you can use market approach. And thirdly, asset approach, asset or cost approach, you can use these three, yeah, these three approaches to value private company, yeah, same like the public company. But for income, yeah, for income approach, you have to estimate cash flow, yeah, attach a discount rate based upon the riskiness of the cash flow, and compute a present value. Yeah. Kalau you boleh guna, maknanya kat sini you boleh guna DCF, yeah, under the income approach. How you have to project the cash flows in futures, yeah, and then you have to get the discount rate, yeah, yeah, and then you discount all the future income, and then you get the present value. So the total present value is the market value of the business of the companies. Yeah. So for private companies, the DCF if more appropriate. Yeah. The most, I mean the best method. Yeah. That is the income. The best approach is the income approach. Yeah. Followed by asset approach. Okay, this is some problem, when you want to value private companies, yeah. One of it, there is no market value for either debt or equities. Okay, so the second one, yeah, the financial statement are likely to go back a few years, have less detail and have more holes in them, yeah. So private company, sebab dia boleh manipulate dia punya financial statement, they can manipulate dia punya statement. Normally they manipulate to to reduce the profit, yeah. Bila dia reduce profit, sebab apa? Sebab dia nak kurangkan bayar income tax, yeah. So bila kita dapat the financial statement, the financial statement is not necessarily the true one, ya. Mungkin dia adalah yang make up. So these are two problems, ya, when we value the private companies. Okay, there are also issues, ya, when we want to do valuation for private company. First is cash flow estimation issues, ya. Shorter period, yeah. Private firm often have been around for much shorter time period than most publicly traded firm. There is therefore less historical information available on them. Yeah, selalu kalau syarikat, especially lah, yeah, sole proprietors or partnership, yeah, dia punya lifetime ataupun jangka hayat syarikat tu tak lama, yeah. Biasanya dia buat setahun dua, ya, let's say lah, katalah Brian, ya, dia intend nak berniaga lah. Brian, you nak bisnes apa?
Brian? Yang tadi punya textile, macam Jekyll Moore punya.
Oh, macam Jekyll. Oh, you nak, katalah buka kedai pakaian, kan? So, you buka kedai pakaian, bisnes you nak bagi nama apa?
Brian and Co.
Brian and Co. Tak sedap lah. Brian Textile lah. Ya, yeah, Brian Textile. Okay. So, your business. Kalau business ni tak maju 2-3 tahun, apa you buat? Kalau sole proprietor, you senang je. You tutup je, kan? Suka hati you je, kan? Betul tak?
Yes. Betul.
Lepas tu, you nak buka business lain pula. Katalah you nak buka business macam apa, Tea Life tu. Ya, yeah, bubble tea, jual bubble tea. You buka pula Brian Bubble Tea. Okay. So, as a proprietor senang macam tu je. Ya, yeah, jadi let's say kalau let's say you baru je buka apa ni, ada tadi Brian Textile, ya. Yeah. 3 tahun you approach the business valuer to value your business. Ya, yeah. Sebab you dah boring, you kata I nak jual lah business I ni, I nak pergi buka ada company, ya. Yeah. So it's not easy to value because of the company is there not for a long period of time. Ya, baru lagi. So susah kita nak dapatkan the historical data, ya. Okay. Okay, secondly, a different accounting standard. Yeah, the accounting statement for private firms are often based upon different accounting standard than public firms. Yeah, which operate under much. So for public firm, we know it's operate under much tighter constraint. Yeah, and what to report and when to report. So kalau the public private company ni dia susah sikitlah sebenarnya, kan, sebab because of dia tak disclose sebanyak benda, and then is terdedah kepada manipulasi, ya, yeah. Okay, isu yang seterusnya, intermingling of personal and business expenses, ya, yeah. In the case of private firm, some personal expenses may be reported as business expenses. Yeah, sebab katalah sole proprietor, especially sole proprietor, business tu business you. Yeah, kadang-kadang you beli perabot rumah. Yeah, you beli perabot rumah. You letak kat rumah, beli sofa, letak kat rumah. Tapi resip, yeah, you bagi dekat company, suruh company bayar. So the account tu sebenarnya tak betul. Yeah. Sebab kalau as a company, patutnya all expenses semua yang kena related to the business. Ya, personal expenses tak boleh dimasukkan, ya, dalam the business account. Ya. So kalau kita guna juga the account, ya, the financial statement yang tadi tu, jadi the end result tu tak betul lah. Ya. Okay. Nak betul, separating salaries from dividends, ya. Yeah. Kalau sole proprietor ni dia macam ni je. Kadang-kadang tak boleh kita nak bezakan, ya, antara itu gaji ataupun itu adalah dividend. Sometimes kadang-kadang kalau partnership ke sole proprietor ke, ya, yeah, ataupun saya dekat Sdn Bhd sekalipun, ya, yeah, dia tengok company tak ada untung. Dia tak ada untung. Dia cakap, "Oh, apa ni, owner tak boleh ambil gaji, ya, tak boleh ambil gaji this month because company tak ada untung. Kita lepaskan gaji staff saja dulu." So consider as tak ada gaji. Tapi bila company tu ada untung balik, ya, banyak untung balik, okey, kita take semua gaji kita, lepas tu kita ambil lagi extra. Itu kalau private company you can do like that. Kan? So menyukarkan, ya, menyukarkan kita lah as business valuers, ya, sebab in the accounts salaries tu itu dikira sebagai expenses of the company, sedangkan dividends tu ia adalah apa ni, diperolehi daripada profits, ya, keuntungan. Okay. So kena ada separation between the two. Okay, this is the three broad scenarios, ya. Yeah. Private to private transaction, you can value a private business for sale by one individual to another. So ini sebenarnya mengapa business valuation tu diperlukan, ya, sebab mungkin nak berlaku transaksi, ya, between private kepada private. Let's say just now lah, Brian and Co nak jual Brian and Co kepada orang lain, ya, kepada Mr. Chong. So you have to value, ya. Sebab yang kedua, private to public transaction. So you have to value the private company sebab mungkin this private company nak dibeli oleh syarikat public listed company, ya, yeah. They want to buy over, ya, yeah. So private to IPO. Kadang-kadang you dilantik untuk menilai the business sebab company ni let's say company syarikat Sdn Bhd. Let's say Jekyll lah eh. Jekyll is syarikat Sdn Bhd. Tapi dia they want to go for IPO. Dia orang nak jadi public listed company. Ya. Yeah? Ni IPO ni tadi I lupa nak bagi tahu you, dia adalah initial public offering. Ya. Yeah? Okay. So dia perlukan business valuer ya yeah, untuk value dia business ya yeah. Supaya kita tahu berapa value dia dan based on the value tu dia boleh tentukan ya yeah, berapa saham yang perlu dikeluarkan dan berapa harga saham ya yeah, untuk setiap saham yang dikeluarkan. Okay. So yang ketiga ni dia lebih kurang macam yang keempat ni dia lebih kurang nombor tiga juga ya. Yeah. You can value a private firm that is expected to raise venture capital ya yeah, along the way on its path to going public. Ini sebelum dia pergi public ya, yeah, dia nak tahu ya yeah, modal ya yeah, venture capital. market value of the business or company itu they want to know yeah. Okay, this is example this example is for income approach yeah. I tak nak ni yeah. Jadi example kat sini I nak ni jadikan you punya exercise. Ya, sebab kat bawah I dah buat another example. So this one is for income approach. Nanti you buat sendiri. Okay, so step dia you have to calculate all this. Ya? Okay. Kita stop sekejap boleh tak? 5 minit. I nak minum lah dahaga.
Boleh. Thank you.
Okey, semua dah ada balik ke? Dah semua dah minum air semua? So kita sambung ya. Okey. So how to value shares in a private limited company? Actually it's not easy. It's not easy to value shares in private company. Kat sini kita kata it's a challenging process ya. When numbers of key assumption need to be considered. So kan perlukan a lot of adjustment ya. So you have to be in that understanding of the company and the market it operates. A valuation expert will be able to assist in arriving at a reasonable estimate value of the business by doing a lot of normalization and adjustment. Okay. Kalau you kerja nanti dalam bidang industri ni, you pandailah. Okay. So if you use asset approach yang tadi tu kita guna I cakap masalah market approach, asset approach. Using an asset value approach, the company value is estimated to be worth the value of its asset less its liabilities, taking no account of future earning potential. So the amount calculated represent what would be left for the shareholder if the asset of the company was sold at market value and its liability settled. This method is most appropriate in the case of stable asset-rich business such as property or investment company. Company yang banyak asset. Kalau property company, you tahulah dia ada banyak property lah as asset. And kalau investment company, dia ada banyak duit. Okay. Market approach, macam biasa, you use price over earning valuation methodology. It's one of the most widely used valuation multiples techniques. So, however, you tak boleh guna the public listed company for private company health. Jangan nanti you value private health company, tapi you you ambil comparable the public listed company. Okay, seterusnya income approach. Saya rasa the best approach for private limited company is income approach. Okay, the value of any company lies primarily in its ability to generate future cash flows. And it's widely agreed that one of the purest method of valuation is the DCF valuation. This approach seeks to estimate the value of a company based on expected future cash flow. But you have to remember, the future cash flow to based on historical data, historical data that you project, in the future. Jangan you saja-saja project, lepas tu dapat value tinggi. And then lagi satu penting, bila you buat DCF, the discount rate tu mestilah betul, So remember, ICAP approach relies on the availability and accuracy of the forecast. Sebab tu saya kata forecast you kena betul, kena accurate. Jangan simply just put figures. You kena ada justification. Why you put that figure. You have to show your projection. And then the second one is the discount rate. Discount rate ni kena correct, kena appropriate. And then number three, you have to know the industry growth rate. Normally for the future income, you base pada growth rate. Jadi growth rate yang you guna tu must be realistic. How to get the growth rate? You base pada the historical data. You buat calculation on the growth rate. You juga boleh compare with the similar business. Okay, when you do DCF, the forecast will be between 3 to 5 years. tak lama ya. Kalau lama sampai berpuluh-puluh tahun tu dah mengarut namanya ya. Okay, given the reliance of future training performance, the methodology is subjective. Yeah? If forecasts are not robust and reliable. So, kadang-kadang ya, forecast ya, your forecast tu tak reliable. Sebab apa? Mengapa saya kata kadang-kadang kalau you focus future income, ya, dia tak reliable, dia tak betul. Boleh fikir tak mengapa? Saya tak boleh dengar lah mengapa ya. Hello?
Hello, you can hear me? Yes, doktor.
They can hear.
Saya tanya soalan tadi. Kadang-kadang kan you punya forecast tu tak betul. Mengapa?
Kerana mungkin event macam pandemic ini happen, then the income approach will not be accurate.
Kalau you boleh jawab kat situ, I senang hatilah, maknanya you faham ya. Okay. Okay, the most widely recognized method for calculating the discount factor is the capital asset pricing model. Yeah. Why? Saya kata tadi discount factors is important kan. So one of the method yang kita boleh gunakan is the capital asset pricing model. Yeah. So the model is used to arrive at an appropriate discount rate by identify the investor's required return for the risk associated with the investment. Once the cash flow has been accurately forecast, then the discount rate can be applied to arrive at the valuation. Yeah. So always remember, when you want to use DCF, yeah, DCF, either DCF in business valuation or property valuation, yeah, there are three things that you have to know. Yeah. Pertama, the future income. Yeah. Yang tu penting lah because you want to discount it. Yang kedua, the discount rate. Ya, di discount rate you kena ada. Dan discount rate ni memang akan affect the value. Ya. Kalau the higher the discount rate, the lower the value or the higher the value. Dah confused dah. Sama juga macam traditional valuation kan, yield kan. The higher the yield, kalau you capitalize kan, at 3% you dapat this figure, at 5% you dapat this figure. Ya. Yeah? Tapi kalau you nak dapat value tinggi, the lower the yield kan. I tak nak bincang lah, you yes. Kira lepas ni. You kira lepas ni ya. Yeah? Okay, dan yang ketiga, what you should know is the growth rate. Mengapa you perlukan growth rate? Sebab you nak kira income in future, yeah? Income in future. So you kena tahu the growth rate every year berapa persen. Yeah? Untuk tahun pertama, let's say tahun pertama 50,000. Tahun kedua, based on the growth rate, katakan ada kenaikan every 5 years, ada kenaikan 5% per year, so you can get future income in the year 2 and year 3 and so on. Yeah. Okay. While the cash flow has been accurately forecast, then the discount rate can be applied to arrive at a valuation. Okay. Okay, so we can say that to find the reasonable market value, yeah, it relies on the combination of analysis, expertise and professional judgment. Sebab itulah kita kata valuation is an art and science. Yeah. Analysis, dia melibatkan mathematical. Expertise, your expertise ni melibatkan art. Yeah. Your professional judgment juga melibatkan art. Kan? Dah belajarkan first year dulu, what is valuation? Valuation is an art and science of blah 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 kan? Ingat tak? Tak ingat dah. Brian ingat tak? Siapa ajar dulu?
Remember.
Remember. Okay. Okay, which is important for business owner and potential purchaser to understand what can influence and value of a company. It is always recommended the professional advice from an independent valuation expert is obtained. Yeah, kita lah tu ya, the independent valuation expert. Okay. Okay, so this is an example of valuation exercise. Yeah. Okay, let's read together. Surveyor Myra James owned MJ Property Valuation, which she established 20 years ago in Kuala Lumpur. Yeah, she is now 60 and wants to retire and sell the practice. Yeah, dah 60 tahun nak retire lah, malas dah buat valuation. In the initial meeting to discuss engagement, she disclosed that she started thinking about retirement when one of classmates from his college, who was also a registered valuer, recently sold his practice. Yeah. Surveyor Zamri Atan of his IQ real estate valuation for $5 million. Yeah. So recently, Zamri Atan ni jual dia punya company yeah, at $5 million. Yeah. MJ revenues for the most recent were 2.35 million, and IQs were 2.75 million. This is their recent revenue. Yeah. Through market review, it observes that the capitalization rate used for dental practice is 20%. Bila diberi capitalization rate, maknanya you akan guna the traditional income method. Yeah. The seller free cash flows per year are 77,000 ya, yeah? Perpetual. Okay. So you have been appointed as a business valuer to determine the fair market value for sale purpose. Yeah, you have to assist Myra Jones ya, yeah? To value her business, yeah, her company. The premise value shall on a going concern basis. Upon investigation, you found the following information. Yeah, you get all this information. Yeah, the net fixed asset, cash in hand, account receivable, other current asset, retained earning, long-term debt, account payable. Yeah, and Myra Jones had allocated 10% for writing off its debts. Yeah. Okay, so you have to determine her practice value based on the three common valuation approach. Suggest which approach is the best. This is the question. So let's see. Yeah. First, yeah, we answer using the market approach. So we have to find the PS ratios here, yeah, for the comparable company. We have comparable company. Comparable company, our comparable company is IQ Real Estate Valuation. Yeah. So you get the price over sale ratio at 1.82 million. So you find the fair market value for Myra Jones. Yeah. So PS ratio times revenue or sales. So you get the fair market value of MJ ratio of this much. Yeah, okay. Senang je, kan? And then we go to the income approach, yeah.
Doctor,
value of MJ. Yeah.
Sekejap. Untuk dia punya yang slide tadi kan?
Ha, dah.
Punya
dah
revenue pada 2350 ke 2750?
Yang 2750 ni comparable.
Oh, okay.
Comparables, kita gunakan this revenue ni untuk dapatkan PS ratio for the comparables. Kita dapat banyak ni. And then we said the we can adopt this comparable because it's similar to our business. It's also a valuation firm, right? then we dapat disclosure with times hour lah, ya, yeah, kita punya revenue. So this is a income approach, ya, yeah, income approach. Value of MJ equal the present value of its free cash flows, ya, yeah, earning before interest, tax, apa, depreciation and amortization. Okay, the capitalization rate given 20%, free cash flow EBITDA given, ya, yeah, 777,000, ya, yeah. So you just get this free cash flow over EBITDA punya apa ni ratios, and then you got the fair market value of 3.885 million. Yeah, that is the income approach. So finally, the last approach is the asset approach. Yeah. So value equal the individual value of all assets. So fair market value of Myra Jones is total assets, all the total assets tolak total liabilities. Yeah. Information given sebelum ni. Yeah. Previous. Yeah. Information given. Yeah. You guna all this information and do this calculation. Yeah. Total asset minus all the total liabilities. Yeah. Okay. So why here? We times 0.9% plus on the account receivables. Sebab, ya, yeah, is already stated.
Sebab tadi dia ada bayar debt kan?
Dia ada. Okay, dia ada kat sini. Dia kata MJ has allocated 10% for writing off his debts. Okay, so that's why we just we kena tolak lah 10%, ya, yeah. Tolak 10% sama lah dengan times 0.9, ya, yeah. And then you get all this and you get the fair market value, yeah, of MJ at 2.33 million. So tengok ada perbezaan kan, asset approach you dapat 2.33 million, income approach you dapat 3.885 million, market approach you dapat 4.27 million. So you nak pakai yang mana? Now we do the reconciliation of the value. So you nak pakai yang mana? Ada tiga figure ni, and the business valuer is you. So you nak pakai yang mana?
Tukar.
Ataupun nak apa, macam biasa you buat pandai-pandai cari average. Yang mana? Siapa jawab tu? I tak dengar. You nak pakai income. Siapa jawab? Siapa yang nak pakai income? Mengapa you nak pakai income?
Saya. Tapi ini based on personal perception lah. Since the owner is selling the company, putting a price too high or too low would not be beneficial.
Kalau you as owner, you nak jual, mestilah you nak jual harga paling mahal kan?
But as a value, we must think of the buyer also, right? So if let's say we put low, then the owner is not getting any money, and if you put too high, then the buyer is paying too much. So I would say
that macam ni. When you want to sell a business or a company or property, whatever, if you took, if you letak asking price too high, nobody want to buy, right?
Yes.
Orang tak tanya pun, mengarut lah orang ni nak jual mahal sangat. If you took, offer too low, you rugilah sebab you nak jual kan?
Yes.
So this is one of the answer. Macam mana how you answer, ya? So for this business specialist, dia cakap the best approach to value MJ property is the income approach due to earning driven business, ya? Yeah? Okay, the market approach is not very useful because only one transaction data is available. Satu transaction data je, apa company IQ tu je, ya? Yeah? Suppose kita kena cari banyak similar comparables. Yeah. Asset approach is not useful because it assumes shareholder equity, the net value alone, and doesn't account for any good bil. Ya, dia tengok aset je, aset yang ada dengan hutang yang ada. Tolak je dapat. Ha, tu budak sekolah pun boleh buat kan. Ha. Technically, asset approach is to be applied only if no willing buyer can be identified for the whole practice. Ya, katalah you dah 10 tahun nak jual, tak laku-laku lah, you let go lah at the asset approach. Ya, dapat balik modal. Ya, okay. So, faham tak? Kelas, faham tak? Saya dah sakit tekak dah.
Faham,
tekak.
Faham.
Faham, ya. So kalau you faham, I think kita akan stop kat sini. Tapi please remember to do this one. Nanti kita bincang sama-sama. Eh, mana tadi soalan tadi dah hilang. Saya nak bincang yang ni. Lepas tu saya fikir yang ni dia only tak seclear yang last tadi. So yang ni I want you to do this exercise, ya. Okay. So kalau tak ada apa-apa, ada soalan? Any question?
Doctor, I have a question about the assignment. Can I share screen for my income approach?
Income approach. Boleh share lah. Mungkin kawan-kawan you pun boleh tolong. Okay.
Hold on, let me open.
Nanti saya kena stop. I punya sharing dulu.
Okay.
Handshot. I dah stop. You can share now.
Okay, sharing. Doctor, can you see my screen?
Belum, yes.
So this one is our income approach. The thing is, our growth rate is so high. So it makes, it's 26.28%. So it makes the firm value to be extremely high at 745 billion. When compared with the asset approach, right? Even after we add the goodwill, you get 24 billion. Compared with the market approach, only 9 billion, 11 billion, and 11 billion. So this income approach is like 74%, 74 times the value of the market approach.
Okay. Why your growth rate is very high? Betul ke? You calculate.
Betul. Kerana EBITDA bagi top growth for this year, right, they rose 4 times compared to last year due to COVID-19.
COVID-19 kan still berjalan.
Doctor, yeah. We are top glove. Top glove memang COVID-19 dia.
Oh, top glove. Ha. Kalau macam ni, you kena buat normalization. No, I mean you tak boleh ambil yang guna yang 1 year je. Yang daripada sekarang you ambil growth tu kan. Yang you ambil sekarang ni, yang you compare last year to this year, right?
No, I get a CAGR compared with 2016 and 2020.
Okay, kalau every year, kalau you tengok yang every year sahaja, macam mana?
Every year sahaja. Tunggu sekejap lah, saya buat sekarang.
2017, 2018. Jangan sekalikan, jangan lamkan.
Tapi doktor, what we find for the infant explanation part lah, is like that all the analysis are talking about the top glove, the NIMA will just continue to increase in the future and won't reduce already because the demand for top glove is continue to increase. Even without the COVID thing, it still continue to increase every year already. Like pre-COVID,
if your opinion that is going to continuously grow, yeah, you can defend your justification. You just adopt the income method lah, and then you
will use
all
this.
your judgment.
So we don't have to change anything lah.
Tapi I don't think ya, dia punya growth sebab kalau you fikir logik, growth dia kalau tak ada COVID this year, adakah dia akan naik macam ni?
Starken, but the situation has already happened, so they can only use the real figure. And the COVID-19 is not going to subside suddenly now, based on projections.
Lagi satu for me lah, yeah. My personal opinion lah, my personal opinion. The growth from last year to this year memang jump, yeah, memang jump tinggi because of the COVID, yeah. But next year to this year, memang akan ada increase, yeah, sebab semua orang akan still guna glove kan, due to COVID ni. Tapi dia punya growth for this year to next year, I don't think is as high as last year to this year.
Yes, I think so too. So how do we deal with this growth rate?
Sebab itulah I kata growth rate you kena tengok juga yang you kena buat every year juga. Ya, yeah, you buat every year yang yang you ada data from 2016 to 2017. You tengok growth rate dia berapa. Ya. Yeah? And then 2017 2018 tengok growth rate dia berapa. Ya.
Yeah? Jadi this is year on year one.
This is year on year. Dah ada dah.
Yeah. And this one is the average. But if you use average, it kind of
Okay, 2016 is 6 negative.
Yeah, 2017 negative. Is less than
no growth lah, yeah. 2017 41%. Tinggi pula. Lepas tu negative balik.
Sebenarnya macam ini. So this one is 2019 to 2020.
Ni dah kumulatif kan? Ya, ni semua kumulatif. Kalau tak kumulatif, kalau year by year.
The year by year is like this. The average will be 20. But we are taught to use the AGR,
because it jadi 20. Because walaupun yang ni tak ada growth kan, 2017 tak ada growth, 2018 growth dia quite extensive, 41%. 2019 tak ada growth. 2020 naik mendadak kat sini kan? Bila you average kan 4 years memang you dapat 20%. This 20% ni sebabkan the increase in from 2019 to 2020 saja. Apa kata you cuba dapatkan the average yang sebelum ni up to 29 saja berapa? And then
up to 29 will be this 4
will be 3 lah. This 3.
Oh, this one is actually the median, not the average. Sorry,
So if you want the average of this one, you buat kat sini, you buat nanti tengok apa perbezaan dia, and then you use your justification to adopt a more realistic average. Yeah.
So doctor, it's like this: the growth rate we use 16 to 19, but the revenue we still continue with the latest one lah.
Apa maksud you, Liguan?
For the growth rate, because it's too high, so you think we don't include the 2020, right? Average from 2016 to 2019.
No. I just want you to get the average before the 2020. So I want to see the difference.
Doctor, I don't know for you to see. Average of
2016 until 2019.
It will be 11.39%.
So when you justify, when you want to adopt the, now you're using 20.15%, right? For the group.
I'm using 26.28, the median.
Oh, the median.
Yeah. Of the AGR.
The median of the AGR. I think you cannot use that. It's too high. Yeah? You just find the median because you use median here. Yang ni average lah, yang tahu. You use median here, so you use median is only up to 2016 to 2019. But then when you justify on the growth. Bila you explain on the growth, you kata based on this from 2016 to 2020, the median for the growth is this one. Okay, but then due to the COVID-19, the increase ya, the growth has jump ya, significantly ya, secara apa ni sangat tinggi. You don't think it will continue ya, like that. So you also see the medium between from this year only to 2019. Let's say you dapat berapa kat situ? You dapat kurang lah ya. And then from that you say you kena cakap lah you as embassy, you are of the opinion the more realistic growth rate is at how much? Yeah. You kena explain banyak lah. Faham tak?
So doctor, what if I choose this growth rate and then I do adjustment to this growth rate? Is it possible to do like that?
Yeah lah, if you want to adjustment, but adjustment pun you kena ada, you have to justify. So one of your justification is, if no pandemic, what is the growth rate? Faham tak?
Sedikit dah faham kan?
Tak, let's say you say you want to use the growth rate, tapi and then you want to discount it or whatever lah. Yeah, you want to do adjustment kan? All adjustment you have to be able to justify why. Like, let's say you discount 50%. Why you discount 50%? You have to know why you discount 50%. Then cara you nak explain is you cakap if no pandemic, you know, kalau tak ada pandemic in 2020, the growth rate, the normal growth rate daripada, you tengoklah berapa dia punya growth rate from 2016 up to 2019 saja.
Tapi the growth rate after the pandemic will be different from the growth rate before the pandemic.
Yelah, yang tu saya faham lah, dia berbeza. Susah nak cakap bila you ni tak ada art, you hanya ada science.
Okay, so doctor, what it means, as long as we can justify, so
tapi okay, saya akan tengok, kalau you justify mengarut, saya akan tolak banyak markah.
Tapi kami akan minus sikit lah sini, terlalu banyak.
Jangan minus sikit tau, I rasa you kena minus banyak ni dalam this case.
Okay, then we minus banyak.
You tengoklah top glove tu dia.
Doctor,
you boleh dapat comparable tak? Selain dari top glove ada tak?
Comparable is ya.
Dia punya glove macam mana? Tinggi juga?
5.98.
Dalam case ni, you boleh gunakan ya glove. You kirakan glove of the comparables, ya. Yeah. You juga boleh tengok growth of the top glove itself, tapi growth dia until 2019 saja, yeah. And then this all you boleh guna untuk you justify when you want to discount the growth yang you dapat yang high tadi, okay? Faham tak?
Saya tak faham how to discount the growth rate. Based on the
yang tu you kena guna you punya art, you punya expertise. Saya tak boleh kata tolak 10%, tolak 20%, ya. Sebab tu saya selalulah kalau mengajar kelas, saya selalu cakap relation is an art and science, ya. Then saya perhatikan our student, you all lah normally ya, tends to look at evaluation ni as a mathematical exercise. No, evaluation is not a mathematical exercise, ya. Kena ada expertise and you have to know how to justify.
Doctor, is it possible that I link the prospects of the future post-pandemic growth rate from the annual report or market research? And then
boleh juga. That all semua boleh jadi you punya basis. Yeah?
And then I use this median and then minus the justification from the market research. Then I get a lower growth rate. It's possible like this one.
Minus the justification macam mana?
Maybe I get I try to find the market growth rate for the
okay, katalah you punya, you dapat growth rate 26.28%, yeah? From comparable, you dapat growth rate like 10%. From report, you dapat growth rate like 15%. You use your expertise, yeah, to get a more realistic growth rate for your business.
Okay.
Okay,
eh? Okay. Thank you, doctor.
Welcome. Okay, anything else? You can stop sharing. Ada soalan lagi tak?
Hello, doctor. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Siapa ni? Hello.
Hello, doctor. Can you hear me?
Not really. Sayu. Slow sangat. Hello. Hello.
Doctor, I help Hui Min to ask.
Kejap ya, because I have to.
Just Hui Min saying that can she use AAGR instead of CAGR for the income approach, but she will provide the justification later below the approach.
You just do. You just consider you as expertise. If you want to use something, you must have justification on that. Okay.
Okay. I think she listened.
Any question? Tanya cepat-cepat because I have to go off at 11. Yeah, I have the class lepas ni. Kita ada berapa minit lagi? 8 minit lagi. Okay, I stop recording first. Okay, if no question, yeah, we stop now, yeah. I think I need a few minutes to rest before I start my class. Thanks. Okay. Tak ada soalan ya? Betul tak ada soalan? Tak Ashwin, ada. You nak tanya soalan ke?
Tak ada.
Tak ada. I tengok you.
Masih tak ada.
Okay, kalau tak ada, kita...